Penguin Random House New Zealand Audio proudly presents The Denniston Rose, written by Jenny Pattrick, narrated by Jennifer Ward-Lealand. All rights reserved.
Author Introduction. Hello, audio listener. I'm Jenny Pattrick, the author of The Denniston Rose. People often ask me why I chose to write about the isolated coal mining settlement of Denniston, now a ghost town on the west coast of New Zealand. I'm not a coal miner's daughter, nor am I from the west coast, but once on a holiday with my husband and elderly mother, we visited that bleak plateau. The mist was low and it was cold. Here and there, an odd brick chimney or set of concrete steps poked out among scrubby bush. No sign of houses. The settlements were long gone. You could feel the ghosts. We sheltered under a tiny tin roof and read an ageing information board. Over 100 years ago, this plateau was a thriving settlement of 3 towns, producing some of the best coal in the world. Coal was lowered down from this very spot, we read, in coal wagons, 2,000 feet down to sea level, on the precipitous railway incline. When the first coal miners and their families arrived from England, there was no road up to Denniston, not even a foot track. The families, the information board said, had to be hauled up in empty coal wagons as the full ones roared down in the opposite direction. After that terrifying trip, many women wouldn't go down to sea level again for 25 years until the road was built. What a story. I started to write about those isolated women, a miner's wife, an innkeeper's wife, and an ex-gold town entertainer. Somehow the child, Rose, crept into the story and took over. At the time I was concerned about a child I knew who was neglected, but who never went under, a survivor. I made Rose a survivor too. The coal mining community was too busy with their own struggles to notice what was happening to little Rose, who had no capable adult to care for her. That can, of course, happen today too. These days, there are wonderful interpretation panels on Denniston Plateau, with old photographs and descriptions of life in the early days. There's also a self-guided Denniston Rose Trail, with numbered white markers featuring a rose and a heart of coal. You can get a brochure from Westport Information Centre or Coal Town Museum that will guide you. I hope you enjoy listening to Jennifer Ward-Lealand's wonderful reading of my novel.
Arrivals. Rose. Rose of Tralee and her mother arrived on the hill at night during a storm. Con the brake insisted it was the worst storm of 82, possibly even since the mine opened, though that was hotly debated. There were, after all, plenty of good examples to argue over, like the one in 1880, where the wind, screaming unchecked over that dead plateau, drove hail 30 feet into Banbury Mine, sending young Jimmy Cotter, who fancied it was a cave-in, screaming for the entrance. Or those terrible 3 days, January was it? The next year, 30 inches of rain in 36 hours and mud up to your knees around the breakhead. That was the same storm blew one of the new miners' tents, wooden floor and all, off the camp and down into the gully, taking Tom Garter and Willie Huff with it. You couldn't have a worse storm than that. And they closed the incline that time. Con the Brake had never been known to concede a point in an argument. Well, he would say, hammering his great fist on the rough plank that served as Red Minifee's bar table, they should have closed it the night Rose arrived. Running loaded wagons down the incline was tricky enough in broad daylight, you know, with no wind. Only that night, there was a bloody order to fill, remember? And the company facing ruin, and naturally those mean bastards put money ahead of men's safety every time. You know it's the truth. It's true, anyway, that the weather was bad that night. A gale force westerly came straight off the sea, heavy with salt and rain. Down there at sea level, on the narrow band of swampy land trapped between black mountains and stormy sea, in the tiny settlement of Waimangaroa, unpainted iron on the new company houses heaved and squealed against nails not yet settled in. The storm roared inland, over the town, over the flat coastal strip, straight up the gully towards the mountains. In the gorge, the river rose and ran oily with a mixture of mud and coal slack. Great, ancient beech trees groaned, their slapping branches showering tiny leaves into the shrieking air. At the head of the gully, the wind butted, whump, into the black rampart of the escarpment, bent almost vertical, and raced on up, 2,000 feet up, howling all the way up to Denniston. Rose's mother never said why she chose to arrive at night, let alone in that storm. In another town, people would worry away at a mystery like that, gnawing at the hard, bright bone over teacups and white lace tablecloth. But plenty of people at Denniston had secrets. There was a saying that every living soul on the hill had been chased up there by the law or some other fury, that they had escaped onto that desolate plateau and then somehow mutated like a tough breed of goats into a race that actually enjoyed mist and cold and isolation. The recruited English miners would be an exception, perhaps. No secrets there. They were on the hill to work, to hew coal and get on with it. Con the Brake, himself a walking treasure chest of secrets, would say that generations underground in the Midlands had mutated the English miners before they arrived. So no one knew what brought Rose's mother. She must have been desperate, that was obvious, considering who she was coming to join and the manner of her arrival. But you didn't ask nosy questions on the hill, and she never offered a reason. Not to folk who might pass on the gossip, anyway. Rose's mother was never one you could have a normal chat with. There was some kind of angry fire burning in that woman, a fire that had been damped down with too much slack. Most of the time, she smouldered away in some private world of her own, walked past as if the rest of the world didn't exist. If she decided to speak, the words blazed out, shreds and tatters of speech, not decent sentences you could respond to. A hint of some foreign lingo underlying her words. Also a touch of madness. An embarrassing woman, was the general opinion, with her shouts, snorts of laughter, hands in all directions. Who would know whether she was enjoying herself or in a furious temper? The truth was, Rose's mother was always too difficult, too uncomfortable. Would it have made a difference if one of the other women had befriended her? It's debatable. Con the Brake, on the other hand, every bit as foreign as Rose's mother, with a past every bit as mysterious, was as open as the sea with his friendships and favours. That night might not have been the best moment to judge, mind you. Being on duty on such a night like this would strain the good nature of a saint. Never one to hold back in the words department, Con let loose a good flow in at least two languages, shouting and cursing at the blinding rain, the money-grubbing mine manager, the icy cold iron of the brake controls. Rain and hail blind the little window of the brake shed. He risked leaving for a moment, the two handles that had become, over the past 2 years, like extensions of his own arms. Out on the platform, he peered down the rails over the edge of the bluff. The lantern, swinging on the tail of the descending loaded wagon, had disappeared into the storm. Somewhere below, the empty wagon was rising in the wild dark, its lantern equally obliterated. "Shut your mouth!" yells Con the Brake to the hook man. Con's temper frays to a strand under pressure. "How can a bod count of your yak?" The hookman, in dripping oilskins and dripping moustache, shrugs and turns away. If Con can curse while he counts, you'd think he could pass the time of day too. But no one wants to be responsible for an accident. Better to stay mum. He taps a wooden chock, testing its fit under the wheels of the waiting full wagon, then crouches under its sloping metal side, taking what cover he can from the storm. Back in the shed, Con counts seconds in some other language. A newfangled invention attached to the drum is supposed to tell him the position of the wagon, but he doesn't trust the thing. A man's experience and judgment is better in a storm like this. His great fists handle the wheels with surprising delicacy. These wheels, smaller than wagon wheels but similar, are mounted waist-high, horizontal to the concrete floor. On each, a knob like a cheerful thumb tucks into Con's paw. He turns one wheel a quarter, the other less. Cold water flows into the pistons, cooling them. Towering behind him, the great winding drum slows and slows again. Better safe than sorry tonight. The wire rope, snaking round and round the drum and quivering with the tension of its two burdens, a descending full wagon and an ascending empty one, groans as it gives out more slowly on the company side, takes up the same slowing speed on the donkey. This time the empty wagon is being hauled up on the donkey side. That's the north. Why donkey is a mystery. Company, you can understand. Nearer to Westport, the Cardiff of the South Seas, where the streets are straight, where the manager wears a clean shirt every day and lives with his wife in his comfortable, dry home. Con the Brake and the Hookman are both peering into the howling darkness, Con hoping to hell he's got the timing right and not slowed the bloody thing too soon. John Gantry Sr., Hookman, waiting to uncouple the empty, hook up the full one, and run the empty on down to the bins for reloading. Four more full wagons and the shift's over, please God and good luck. First, they see a pale halo of light rising through cloud and rain. The lanterns wagging back and forth in the wind as if signalling a disaster. Con grunts. Timing's right enough. He winds with a will now and the great brake drum groans. If the wagon comes over too fast, John Gantry could be history and Con out of a job. Con nods grimly. Good, good. Here she comes nice and sweet over the brow. Next they see, like some unlikely ghost story, a pale face swimming in and out of the rain and mist. Holy Mary, there's someone coming up in the wagon. A woman by the shape of the hat and the size of her. Not crouching down, taking what cover she might from the sloping metal sides, but upright, straight as a tree and grim. She comes up inside the wagon, clinging to the leading side as if it were a ship's prow, feet apart like a man, leaning her good black coat into the rusty metal. Both arms are stretched wide, hooked over the lip to hold her firm against the steep grade and the storm. A plume of coal slack, whipped off the descending wagon as it roared down past her, must have caught her full in the face. Now rain and wind have etched lines on the sooty mask. Her skin is a shifting landscape like moonlight on a dark river. The woman stares ahead, the one still thing in this buffeting night. That wagon, rising up an impossible slope on a filthy night, is most definitely in her charge. Metal wheels squeal on wet rails. The wagon comes level and mounts the siding ramp. Even Con the Brake is silenced by the apparition. John Gantry Sr. stands in awe. For a single moment, the woman turns her head and looks down at Con. He jerks violently as if an electric current has struck up at him through his controls. Then the bell announcing the safe arrival at middle break of a full wagon reminds them all that nothing waits for the company. Even the woman seems to know this. She stands braced while the streaming hookman knocks out the pin, heaves the great metal hook from its socket and lays it on the ground. He pushes her wagon gently ahead towards the bins and goes back to the hook. Grunting with effort, no one's going to tell him he's getting past it. He drags the heavy hook and its 4-inch cable over to the full wagon, waiting poised on the edge. First, he uncouples the safety rope. Now he rams a hook home and drives in the locking pin. Last, he taps out the chock from under the wheels and gives Con the nod. Bells ring. The great drum groans and turns. The cable leaps up and snaps taut. The wagon moves. 4 minutes on the dot, 7 more ton of bright coal hurtles down, down to Middle Break and then on down to Con's Creek. The Denniston Incline, engineering masterpiece, 8th wonder of the modern world, 1,800 feet in 2 near-vertical drops. With his hands still on the controls, counting still, Con watches over his shoulder. He's shaking. In the wavering light from the pump house lamps, he sees the woman reach down into her wagon. She hands out 3 wet bundles, which John places carefully on the mud of the siding. The first is a brown leather suitcase, battered but decent. Then comes a large bundle, linen perhaps, wrapped in tarpaulin and tied with a string. The third, also wrapped in tarpaulin, is a child. A small hole cut in the stiff canvas shows a wet face with sharp, interested eyes. String tied under the child's chin and around the back of her neck turns the square of tarpaulin into a dark hood and cape. Ah, Jesus, Con moans. Jesus. The mother hands her out like any other parcel. John Gantry Sr. takes the child gently as a handful of suds and puts her little boots on the driest patch he can find. She stands by the other luggage, hardly distinguishable in shape and size, but a wonder to Con and the hook man. The mother takes John's offered hand, allows herself to be lowered to the ground. She bellows words into the wind, and Con can see by the way John shrugs that he hasn't heard. The woman pushes back her streaming hair in a gesture familiar to Con and shouts again. This time John gathers the gist. She's asking for Jimmy Cork's place. John Gantry Sr. looks sharply over to Con the brake, who stares down at the rail, pretending he hasn't heard. Jesus save us all, mutters Con. And especially me. Later that night, Con, washed and nightgowned, slides his tree trunk of a body between clean sheets and wakes up the woman, soft and warm as dough, who is the joy of his life and is known on Denniston as Mrs. C. Rasmussen, Con the Brake's wife. She explodes. What? She shouts so half the men's quarters can hear. You never sent a woman and child over to Jimmy Cork's. What could we do? Mumbles Con into the great welcoming bosom. Hookman try all right. He say to her it's a bitty late for a visit. Tell her she might stay at Hanratty's till morning. Mrs. C. Rasmussen snores. A woman arriving in the middle of the night is not going to have money for boarding houses. Totty would not turn her away. Con's hands are gentle on his wife, but the picture of that woman still burns. Maybe it wasn't Angel. Surely that woman would never bed up with Jimmy Cork. All that soot and rain, how could he recognize any poor soul? No, that bad storm has spooked him as all. Mrs. Rasmussen groans, the child. Con's great bleak face, cracked and craggy as fjords in winter, softens into a warmer, rounder landscape. The child, he says, and he needs his woman's, his wife's, lovely flesh. The child smiled at us as if she were out on a Sunday picnic. Terror, you wouldn't be surprised. Or tears, you know. All you could see was 2 eyes and a bitty yellow hair, but that smile, it was like sun coming out, I'm saying it. They went to Jimmy Cork's, demands Mrs. C. Rasmussen, withholding favours till she knows the worst. What chaos might need putting to rights in the morning. They did, woman, mutters Con, hard and ready for her. He's ashamed of his urgency. It won't be her. Please, Jesus, it won't. To Jimmy's. Now let be. I'd say they were survivors both, like we two. Like us, corrects Mrs. C. Rasmussen, and let's be. Evangeline Strauss and Jimmy Cork. If any one moment in those dreadful 2 days might have dented Leni Strauss's indomitable will, this would be it. When she took the direction indicated by the hook man and floundered her way through rain, mud, and goodness knows what stinking else towards some distant tent. A tent, he said. What use was a tent in all this wild weather? If she weren't so cold, she might have sat down and wept. In 4 years, five nearly, Jimmy could surely have done better than a tent. Something had gone wrong, as she'd suspected this past many years. Jimmy was all quick brain and loud mouth, not a grain of good sense to glue him together. If that man had been lying to her, he would shortly have his neck wrung like a chicken. Jimmy had first met Leni Strauss 4 years earlier. Then she was known as Angel, but, by her own laughing admission, was a reasonably tarnished member of the heavenly choir. Angel told Jimmy she was born 1852, which was only 2 years short of the truth. In fact, she was 28, born of German parents at the goldfields of Victoria, Australia. At age 16, she had married a John Anchorage. "Nothing else to do," she would laugh, stamping her fine, narrow feet and tossing her petticoats in the saloon called Angel's Palace, which she ran in Hokitika. "A girl, 16, and every man in the goldfields after a piece of her. That John Anchorage was a good man with his fists. Protection I needed bad." 2 years later, Leni Anchorage travelled with her husband and baby daughter to Chile Oripuki, south of Dunedin, New Zealand, where John's friend, James Kirkton, promised good gold was to be found in the black iron sands. The colour was there all right, but the baby died, and not a month later, John was murdered in an argument over claims. "So then," Leni, who loved recounting her colourful past, would continue, "time to try my own hand at the colour. Haymaking in the sand is not so hard work, but my luck was only so-so. Then I met that bastard Simon Lamb. You remember him, Gaffer. You were here then. Up we come by some hellhole boat that went down 1 year later, here to Hokitika in the high old times. Well, more low, truth was. That Simon dumps me flat to follow a duffer. Stupid fella. When he realises his mistake and comes crawling back for a bit of comfort, he feels a flat of my hand, no? By then I have my own saloon, sitting pretty till some prune-faced lawman does me in. Jealousy was, and did me for spite." Here Angel would sigh and toss her mane of dark hair, till all her audience licked their lips anticipating a taste of her. Some remembered her arrest for prostitution and lewd behaviour. Jailed with 1 month hard labour. Out she came and in a month had opened a new guest house. Oh, Angel Lamb had a grand energy for a high time. Arrested again she was, with more hard labour, but no lawman ever tamed her. By 1878, when Jimmy Cork met her, she was older and, some said, more settled. Her saloon, Angel's Palace on Revel Street, Hokitika, was well patronised. You could always have a good time at Angel's. Jimmy, in particular, came back often for a good time. They were a spirited pair, she with her wild hair and wild ways, he with his knowledge and speechifying. He was not from County Cork, as his nickname suggested, but, some said, from London. His fine singing voice and his flow of language earned him the reputation of an Irishman. Jimmy Cork could down you in an argument no matter what the topic, but always with good humour, mind. "Ah, Angel," he said one night, tickling her beautiful breasts with his ginger beard. "Hokitika is done for, my lovely. The colour's been stripped. The golden future is further north. I have it on good authority." He promised to send for her shortly when he'd found a good stake. No word for several months. By now, Angel is pregnant. Gossip lays the honour evenly to either Mr. Arthur Byatt, the barber, or that giant of a fellow with a shock of blonde hair working down at Gibson's Quay. But Angel plumps for Jimmy Cork. She sends him the news. 6 months later, after her baby is born, Jimmy writes that he's made a great find to keep it under her hat and that he will send for her and the baby shortly. Nothing more for 6 months. Angel, never one for fidelity, gives up on Jimmy and goes for the big fellow at the wharves. Arthur Byatt is already married. The final confrontation is famous. Angel has already been down to the wharves a couple of times to give Big Snow the news that he's the lucky father. He's promptly sent her away. It seems Big Snow is lately patronising a different saloon, and a paternity suit will definitely not assist his hopes with that other sweet hostess. Angel must have been a bit desperate. She wasn't usually one to barge in on someone else's affair, but then Elkitika, as Jimmy had predicted, was on the down. Gold Rush is a thing of the past and the population drifting away. Angel marches a third time down to the wharf, this time with a little girl, golden-haired like Big Snow. When he ignores her, she lets fly. All kinds of obscenities mouthed by those big red lips. The audience could make out only one word in ten. Bella, Big Snow's sweet hostess, heard about it, of course, but never made the connection to Rose till many a year later. She and Angel operated rival establishments and naturally were not on speaking terms. If they had met down there in Hokitika, matters on the hill might have ended differently. But then again, perhaps not. So Angel rages on, shouts, screams, claws at Big Snow, accuses him of every sin under the sun. Quite a crowd gathers to watch. Big Snow, who has a temper himself, holds back for a while, but finally lands a slap on her you can hear right down the quay. Angel runs at him, catches him wrong-footed and pushes him into the drink. A great shout of laughter from the crowd. Angel accepts the applause. Then, amid growing consternation, comes the realization that Big Snow has not surfaced. Someone jumps in to search among the piles. No sign. The tide is on the run. The theory is that Big Snow knocked his head on something, sank, and was dragged out to sea. Angel is not forgiven. Big Snow was popular. Before a charge of manslaughter or worse can be laid, Angel and child disappear. 2 years later, Eleni Strauss with a little daughter turns up at Addison's flat near Westport, haymaking again on the iron sands there and asking after Jimmy Cork. It's not clear what caused her sudden flight up to Denniston. Obviously, she had found out Jimmy's whereabouts, but why the middle of the night? Rose remembers a fight, worse than the usual, over a piece of bread. Another woman was involved, and accusations of theft were laid. It can be assumed that Leenie's temper went over the top again and she struck the woman a blow too severe for even the goldfield community to ignore. Rose remembers her mother hastily throwing things together and then a dreadful tramp through the rain, her mother shouting at her to keep up. They slept in a barn. At Westport, they climbed into an empty coal wagon and waited to be carried up the gorge towards Denniston. Leenie Strauss had no idea what kind of place she was coming to. Up at Denniston, in the dark and freezing rain, Leenie stumbles against a pile of something rotten. Her bundle drops into the mud. Somewhere behind in the dark, the child is crying for her to wait. "Sweet Maria," screams Leenie into the equally furious air. "Help me! Some person help!" She beats the bundle with both fists. "Is some person not here to help?" She tosses her head in a rage and her good hat is swept away into the dark. A mass of damp, ropey hair lashes at her face, cutting swathes in the mask of coal dust. For a moment, Leenie breaks the tantrum to listen for results. The child is caught up now and is holding tight to her coat. "Where is the house?" says Rose. "I'm cold." But before Leenie can resume her shouting, they both hear the bang of a door and see, against the looming wall of a cliff, that there is a row of huts and, from one, a lantern is advancing. The owner of the lantern stumbles, curses, stumbles again, but keeps coming. When his face appears in the circle of pale light, the child Rose backs off and hides behind her mother. The face is badly scarred. A livid slash from hairline to chin, and the skin along the jaw and down the neck puckered like lumpy porridge. The face attempts a grin. "Well, well, my lucky night. The Lord has sent a visitation upon me.
This way, lady, this way. It's snug as a bug in my little hut, and who would want to be out in this bloody mess longer than she needed?
Billy Genesis, one-time jailbird, presently company blacksmith and drunk as usual, shakes himself like a dog to shed the rain. Leanie, a match for any man, drunk or sober, swings her bundle up into his arms.
Thank you, mister, but it's Jimmy from County Cork I'm after. Pleased to take me.
This is an order, not a request.
Jimmy, eh? Says Billy, grinning and nodding. Well, now, he's a partner of mine in a manner of speaking. We share most things.
Leanie gives him a look.
But I'll not queer his pitch on the first night.
He roars with laughter and is about to move in the direction of Jimmy's when he notices the child.
Well, look what is here, he bellows, and raises a finger to point heavenwards. And God Almighty bless thee, and make thee fruitful and multiply thee, that thou mayest be a multitude of people. Genesis 28, verse 3. He lunges to scoop up the child, but Rose, slippery in her stiff coat, dodges away into the dark.
Leanie glowers.
Jimmy Corks, she shouts.
Billy's glazed eyes focus for a moment and begin to spark. This man can be dangerous too. Then he shrugs and moves ahead. The unsteady procession sets off past shacks and tents, then over a narrow track through all kinds of rubbish, iron, timber, coal slack, welded together with stinking mud. Rose wants to hold on to her mother's coat, but her arms are trapped inside the cape. Soon she sees the dim sweep of a tent roof, sucking and billowing in the wind, a black cliff sheer above it. The tent stands alone, nothing but dark storm on each side. There is a wooden door in the tent, and Rose stands in front of it, watching rivers of rain, caught in the lamplight, run over the rough surface and down into the slab of stone below. Her mother is arguing again, shouting at the man to go away, leave her now, this is private. The man laughs and says he's earned the right to stay and see the fun. Rose faces the door, humming to block the sound, and waits. The flapping tent looks like a dying seabird. Billy Genesis suddenly puts down his lamp, grabs the raging woman in both arms and kisses her full on the mouth. Quickly as the drink will allow, which is not quick enough, he moves back then, away from a flailing slap.
Wake up, Jimmy, he shouts, rubbing his livid scar, for the Lord has sent a pestilence upon you. And the Lord sent thunder and hail, and the fire ran along upon the ground, and the Lord rained hail upon the land of Egypt. Exodus 9:23.
Back he stumbles, laughing and shouting, his lantern making mad patterns in the storm, leaving the two alone in the dark. Leanie pounds on the door. Rose waits beside her. Her mother knocks again and then pushes the door open. She calls out and steps into the house. Rose stands close behind her mother in the dark, straining to see. The tent smells. The floor is wet. A man speaks and her mother answers. The man coughs. He coughs again and spits. He knocks something over and it rolls on the floor. Rose hopes he's trying to light a lamp. Her mother steps away into the dark, but Rose waits by the door. She holds both hands under her cape to keep them safe. Then there is a circle of light around a candle. Slowly, a man's face with a red beard, and then the whole place with everything in it comes out of the dark. Rose stares. There is a cave here. Half of the room is a little cave, and half is a tent with a wooden floor. At one end of the tent part is a fireplace, but the fire is out. Rose stays by the door and watches. She tells herself this is a story, a real one, and she is the princess in the cave. The man might turn out to be a wicked stepfather. She watches his face to see what he will do.
Holy Mary, says her mother.
She drops her bundles and goes to stand over the man.
What's happened to you?
The man shakes his head back and forth, back and forth. Once he looks up at her and mutters something, then goes back to his shaking. Leanie groans.
Is every damn person in this hellhole drunk, if not worse. Ah, Jimmy. Jimmy. But her voice is not as angry as usual. Come and say hello to your father, says her mother. Rose bends down to untie her boots because they are muddy and she has been taught to leave them outside, but also because she's afraid of the man. You can leave your boots on, says her mother. So she walks over to the man and stands in front of him. Her mother unties the string around her neck and lifts off the heavy cape and goes to hang it on a nail on the back of the door. The man looks at her. Rose stares back. The wind hits the tent hard and it rocks. The man's eyes are swimming and he puts his head down again and he cries. Ah, Jesus, he says. Ah, Jesus. Where one arm should be, there is a stump hanging from the shoulder and the skin looks angry. Rose reaches out to touch the skin where the arm ends. It feels soft and hot, like a puppy's skin. Hello, she says, and smiles hard. Ah, Jesus, says Jimmy, without looking up to see the smile. At least look at the child to see what you've made, shouts Leenie. She hangs her own hat and coat on the door, then puts the big bundle on the table and unties it. She spreads the layers of cloth carefully and takes from the middle a cardboard box. She lifts off the lid. Rose wants to see in. Don't touch, says her mother in a sharp voice. They're precious. The box has eggs in it, each one wrapped in a piece of woolen cloth. One is broken and a sort of chicken is lying mixed up with the egg. What is it? Asks Rose. But Leenie just picks up the thing by one thin leg, opens the door and throws it outside. Opposite the bed is a rough fireplace and chimney made from rusty iron. The chimney has a wooden frame and the canvas walls are attached to this. Rose's mother takes the box over to the fireplace and puts her hand on the stones. Then she puts her hand in the fire itself and stirs the ashes till she's made a nest. She puts the whole box right in the fire. Rose waits for it to burn up, but it doesn't. Leenie washes her hands in the bucket in the corner. She takes a towel from the bundle and dips it in the water too, and washes the mud off Rose's legs and off her own legs, then wipes mud from the hem of her good coat hanging on the door. Your face is black too, says Rose. Leenie wipes her face and cries out at the black on the towel. What must I look like? Some black savage. She looks over to Jimmy Cork, but all the time he is crying. Ah, Jesus, angel. Ah, Jesus. That's enough of Ah, Jesus, says Rose's mother, and stands in front of him, waiting. Jimmy won't look up. Ah, Jimmy. Jimmy, I'm too tired for all this, says Leenie. Look at you. The arm. The house. So then, the gold was all words, was it? Like your entire life? All a dream? So? All in your head? Jimmy frowns. Don't be so damn sure, woman. There are complications, that's all. And this is not the moment to go into them. Complications? Complications I have plenty myself without yours. Leenie suddenly yawns hugely, the yawn turning into yelping cries like a wounded animal. Ah, 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 what luck I have. Rose thinks her mother might be crying too. She stands on the cold floor and watches while her mother turns away from Jimmy and goes to the bundle again. She takes a blanket from the bundle and another towel. She rolls the towel up and puts it on the platform bed. Pillow, she announces. And Rose understands that she is to sleep next to this man who is her father. Leenie wraps the child twice around with the blanket, lifts her up like a sausage and tells her to sleep at the bottom of her father's bed. Rose doesn't want to. She sits up for a while, leaning against the tent at the farthest corner of the bed. Where she leans, rain comes through, so she sits up straight again. She can't get her hands out to balance, so she can feel herself falling towards the man. Rose thinks she might be going to cry too, but doesn't want to make her mother angry. Jimmy stares at her, his eyes all pale and watery, and a drip hangs off his nose. "What do they call you?" he says. "Rose." "Ah, Rosie, Rosie," says her father. "Ah, Jesus." And he starts to cry again. Rose pulls her head down into the blanket and shuts her eyes. She sings a song to herself about the ride up in the railway wagon and the nice man who lifted her out. She thinks about hot scones in the frying pan, which Mr. Thrush back at the beach used to make for her, and another nice lady who often talked to her. The bundled-up grey sausage that is Rose slowly keels over and comes to rest on her father's feet. She's asleep. Leany takes off her jacket and shakes out her hair. Jimmy turns his shaggy head to watch her. Leany's hair is thick and wild like his, only a darker red. Her body is more solid than he remembers, but splendid still, and her wide red mouth a temptation even in his present state. Over huge black eyes, the eyebrows, thick as a man's and straight as boot brushes, are fiercely at odds with the tender mouth. Jimmy had forgotten the brooding force of this woman, her power to excite. She makes a move towards the bed and then stops, looks around. Out go the arms, flung wide in exasperation. "Where? Where?" she almost shouts. "There's a bucket in the cave. I wasn't expecting company." "You're living like a pig, Jimmy Cork, you who used to be a fine man with education and ideas." "This place is comfortable enough by standards up here," he says, convincing no one. "Comfortable," she snorts, her volatile hands speaking for her as she turns and feels her way into the dark indentation of the cave. He's on fire now, booze and desire mixing in his blood. But there's a stirring also of apprehension. This unpredictable woman will make trouble, and he will have little or no control over her. Evangeline Strauss can no more keep a secret than jump over the moon. Words tumble out of her of their own volition. Nevertheless, he glances down at the sleeping child. Then with a grin, he uses his one good hand to pull out his prick and keep it up until Angel returns. When Rose wakes, there is a greyness to the dark outside that means it's morning. She lies still so as not to wake her mother and the man. She hums a song, but quietly. "Be quiet and go back to sleep," says her mother. Rose lies still, looking up at the canvas. It is black with soot and she can see a drop of water growing where the canvas is nailed to the doorframe. She watches as it falls to the floor and another one starts to grow. When her mother is snoring again, she swings off the bed and holds the blanket around her while she looks for her clothes. She finds her pinafore and a knitted coat made by a kind lady down at the beach. Her stockings and vest and drawers are already on. She finds her hat and puts that on too, but she's still cold. Every now and then the tent roof rattles as if someone is trying to come in. "I don't like this house," thinks Rose. "It was much better at the beach." Opposite the fire is a table, and beside the table are some wooden boxes with things in them. She looks to see if any have food in them. "For goodness sake, go outside and play if you can't be quiet," says her mother. She and the man who is supposed to be her father are lying close together, very still. Rose watches them for a while. When her mother is holding on to a man like that, she usually doesn't hear. Still watching them, she tiptoes to her mother's coat and slides her hand into the pocket. The purse is there. Without taking her eyes off her mother, she snaps open the lock and feels for a threepence. The cold, round feel in her hand is very good. Now she puts on the canvas cape and ties the string around her neck, but not very well because the sides of the cape get in the way. Then she can't do up her boots because every time she bends down, the canvas reaches the floor and the boots are inside under the cape. "Pity's sake, crash, crash," says her mother without looking. "What's the matter now?" "I can't do up my boots," says Rose. "Take your cape off and then do up the boots first, ninny," says her mother. Rose sighs and starts all over again. Outside, she can't see very far. Everything is grey as if she were still under her blanket. The lumpy things they walked past in the night are rocks, not animals. The houses must be there somewhere, but the mist is too thick. The mist smells of coal. She runs at one of the rocks and says boo to it in a loud voice, beating it hard with a stick and laughing at it. In her other hand, the threepence is held so tightly it hurts. She jumps along the path like a rabbit, but her cape bounces up and down and scratches her neck. Now she can see the long row of huts, but she doesn't want to go near there today. She walks past a long building and hears snoring. Lots of loud snoring like a pen of pigs. She snores too, then runs away up the path, past other sleeping huts, looking for one that is awake. Hanratties. The Hanratties had been at Denniston 3 years when Rose and her mother arrived. Totty Hanratty was out in the lean-to, red in the face from trying to get a good heat under the kerosene tins for her boarder's hot water. Just when she thought the coal was catching nicely, a rogue wind would drive rain in round the corner and the yellow-red glow would spit and fade. Totty straightened to ease her back for a moment and saw what she thought was one of the stray dogs from the camp coming up out of the mist in search of breakfast. Another heartbeat and she'd have let fly with a lump of coal. You didn't expect, then, to see a child. It was only her, Michael, and three or four older ones working round the mines. But a child it was. Over her head a square of wet tarp that fanned out right down to her boots. A rough hole had been cut out for her face, and quick blue eyes examined the dismal sight of Dixon Street in the rain. An astonishing sight. The child trotted through the mud as if she owned the place. Forgetting fire and borders, Totty Hanratty goes to the fence for a better look. The triangular bundle, about 4 years old at a guess, zigzags down the lane, looking in windows, until Totty calls her over. The child makes a beeline for her, displaying a smile so sunny it surely must cover something darker on a morning like this. She holds out her hand. A threepenny piece lies on a bloody, muddy palm. "Can I buy some bread here?" she asks, smiling still. "Come in, quick," says Totty, frowning to see the caked blood. She holds open the gate and the little one trots in, trusting as a puppy. "Give me a moment with this fire and then we'll see what we can find." The child stands under the lean-to, close to the fire, which, after all, has got itself going, as soon as no one watching, wouldn't you know it. "The company store is the place you want," says Totty, busy with the shovel and glad to talk to anyone. "Down by the bins. But it won't be open yet, sweetheart. If you're hungry, you can have a bite with my Michael." "Mother and father would want some too." "And who are they?" asks Totty, dying to know. The child frowns and looks at the fire for a bit. "They're still asleep." "Down at the camp, are they?" The child looks at Mrs. Hanratty in a conversational kind of way, like an adult. "I don't know the names here yet. Mother and I only came in the night." Totty smiles, thinking the child has got her times wrong. No one could have arrived last night. Yet it's strange she hasn't heard. Another child, after all. "Well then, so your father has been here for a bit, has he?" "I suppose so," says the child doubtfully. Then the smile comes out again as if she remembers something. "He's called Mr. James of County Cork." The name is pronounced with pride. Totty Hanratty breathes in sharply and can think of nothing to say. She flips two cloths from the nail on the wall, wraps them around the wire handles of a pair of steaming tins, lifts them down, heaves two fresh ones onto the grate in their place, careful not to slop water on the coals. "Well, come in anyway," she says, finally, but her face is less welcoming. The weight of the tins wrenches her arms down, drives her boots deeper as she crosses the yard to the back door. The child follows, the hem of her stiff little cape dipping into the mud with each bobbing step. Totty's stern look melts when she sees the child lay her threepence carefully on the doorstep where she can see it, and unlace her boots one by one. Michael can't anywhere near do that. The hand is clearly giving pain, but the child shakes her head, proud of her skill, when offered help. In the wash house, Totty cleans the wound, sponging gently with some of her warm water.
The thought of this little girl wandering unknown on the hill is almost more than the mind can take in.
That's a nasty gash. Does it hurt?
No, though the smile is stiffer now.
How did it happen?
Totty suspects Jimmy Cork.
There was something sharp in the thing we came up on. It was too dark to see.
The child winces, but smiles again as soon as she's able, as if to reassure the adult. A strange child. There is something too self-contained, almost manipulative about her. Totty shakes her head to chase off these impressions. I am being silly, she thinks. It's the idea of Jimmy Cork. In the kitchen, Michael, warm and golden as a fresh scone, is amusing himself banging porridge spoons like any proper four-year-old. At the sight of the girl in the doorway, his mouth drops open. Then he's off his chair and on the floor in front of her, laughing and pointing. It's the first time Michael has seen anyone his own size. The child's face is equally amazed. She reaches out her good hand, offers the threepence. Michael accepts. Totty wants to keep her. Totty Hanratty, 6 months pregnant, married only two, had been the second woman to arrive on the hill. Mrs. C. Rasmussen, of course, was the first. When Rose arrived, neither woman had left the bleak plateau in 3 years. She was a Maguire, Totty was, a Maguire from Westport. Her father, Mr. Rufus Maguire, owned the general store on Palmerston Street and had shares in the Royal Mail Service to Reefton. He was also a good friend of Mr. Bickerton Fisher, who was expected to represent Buller District in Parliament after the next election. Oh yes, the Maguires were respected in Westport society. Mrs. Maguire saw to that. Rufus Maguire, red-headed as his name suggested, passed the hair colour along with a wilful disposition down to his elder daughter, Dorothy. Everything about this fiery daughter broke her mother's heart. She was a natural beauty, clever and accomplished, sang like a bird, recited long poems to make a grown man cry, was tall but not a beanpole, slim enough not to need corsets, and sunny-natured. The red hair, aggressive bristles in the father's case, on Totty's head, curled softly around her ears and escaped in shining tendrils from the clasp at the nape of her neck. In short, Dorothy Maguire had all the attributes to make an excellent match, yet spent all her days ensuring she would make a bad one. Totty ran on the beach with young people of any station or no station. She walked out of the house without a chaperone and attended entertainments with rowdy lads and lasses. She argued with business partners of her father's and scorned afternoon tea parties with her mother's friends. Totty loved the bush, would climb hills and stony riverbeds like a man. Worst of all, she spent too much time with Tom Hanratty, a rough carpenter's son and a Catholic. Totty Maguire paid her first visit to Denniston in daylight, not a cloud in the sky. March 10th, 1879 it was, 3 years before Rose arrived, and about 300 others were with her. It was not often the mayor announced a public holiday, and who could resist when the company laid on a free train to take anyone with a fancy for adventure to the opening of the Denniston Incline, the eighth wonder of the engineering world, and to be followed by a dance with entertainment down at Waimang? "You'll ride with us in the official party, Dorothy," says Mrs. Maguire. "There is a closed carriage reserved." Her words are abrupt, but the eyes plead. Totty mutters some excuse and runs down the line to the open wagons with plank seats for the working classes. Tom Hanratty's mates laugh and wink to see his fancy girls' lace petticoats flying, showing pretty buttoned boots and a fair bit of ankle too. But Tom leans down proudly and pulls her up as if she were any decent working-class woman. Totty smiles and bobs to Tom's family, sitting in the open wagon behind, and earns a nod, sour as lemon, from Mrs. Hanratty.
"You'd best ride up with your family, Miss Maguire." Her words are square and nasal, causing heads to turn three wagons away. "That dress won't survive the journey out here in the open."
Mrs. Hanratty is dressed head to toe in sensible black against the soot and coal dust, as are all the other women in sight. A worn grey blanket stretches across her broad knees and over the skinny legs of the four youngest Hanratties. Even 10-year-old Meg wears a black kerchief over her curls. Totty stands out like a whore in a nunnery. She sighs.
can't please anyone today. But Tom's warm arm, steadying her as they chuff and rattle up the coast, tells her different. At Waimangaroa Junction, the train stops to take on more picnickers. Tom stands up and waves both arms. Hey, Jacko! It's a holiday, man! Join the picnic! Jacko, perched on the roof struts of a skeleton cottage, banging nails in the morning sun, hears nothing but waves his hammer and grins. It's his own house he's building, shouts Tom in Totty's ear. I could do the same for us if I work for the company. She smiles and nods, though the certainty of family opposition hangs heavy as engine smoke above them both. The train whoops and turns inland towards the gorge. Ahead, bush-clad foothills rise sharply to the plateau. People shout and point up to the distant gash of the incline, the powerhouse chimney rising above it like a preacher's finger invoking the wrath of the Lord. Then the awesome view slides out of sight behind dripping, ferny cliffs as the train creaks its way around the tight curves of the gorge. They pass the bridge across the Wellington mine and see the first workings for the Koronui incline. They say there's wonderful coal up at the Koronui, but getting it down is even more of a problem than from the Rochefort Plateau, where they're headed today. No sign of work today, though, on either Wellington or Koronui. The opening of the incline is an event not to be missed, and even the dour English miners are in a holiday mood. Totty is entranced. On a shining day like this, anything is possible. She turns to Tom, her smile warm as sunlight. Hold still. You've got a smut. She licks one delicate forefinger and touches the flake of soot on his clean white collar. Attracted to spit, it comes away with hardly a trace. Totty squashes it like a bedbug between forefinger and thumb. Tom laughs at the trick and tries to return the compliment. His solid carpenter's fingers approaches a smut on her muslin, but the soft thing collapses and the skirt is smudged. He groans and dabs with his handkerchief. Three more dark shadows appear. Tom looks down at his clumsy hands. Ah, Totty, what have I done? Your dress. His face is desperate. Mrs. Hanratty, tight-lipped, hands forward her own shawl, but Totty declines the dark cover. She will not succumb to propriety, not today. Standing in the rocking wagon so everyone can see, she raises her hands to her hair, drags them slowly over her face, her shoulders, down over the neatly corseted bosom and waist, all the way down to the frilled hem. In the wake of her hands, black flowers bloom over flesh, over lace, over sprigged yellow muslin. Every eye, even Tom's, is scandalized. Totty, now spotted like a black currant pudding, sits. She and Tom ride, straight-backed and silent, up the gorge. Other picnickers exclaim over the size and grandeur of the trees, the sparkle on the river below. The coal seam clearly visible in the wall of the gorge, but how could you ever reach it? Totty blinks, pretending the sun is in her eyes. But when two fat pigeons burst out of the bush, close enough to touch and iridescent as opals, Tom glances sideways in the general stir and winks stoutly at his willful girl. Totty's giggle is half sob. But the day and a dynasty is rescued. It turns out that the bottom half of the incline is not yet functioning. Mr. Dixon, company manager, resplendent in top hat, explains to the milling picnickers that he cannot guarantee the safety of the ladies until the lower brake drum has been inspected. But if the gentlemen would offer a hand to the ladies, they might all make their way safely up over the railway sleepers, up the steep slope of the incline to middle brake, where brand new wagons, untouched by coal dust, are ready to haul them up the second, steeper section of the incline. Several women and a few men, quoting varicose veins, hearts, delicate shoes or dispositions, decide to picnic at the railhead. Conn's Creek is, after all, very pretty, much more suitable than the high plateau. Mrs. Hanratty is one of these. She spreads her rug and sits with the other women, dark and formal in the sun, like heavy boulders guarding against the exuberance of the bush. Others, including Mrs. Maguire, feel their duty is to be at their husband's sides during the opening ceremony. They struggle up over stones and sleepers, but finally quail at the sight of the wagons rising vertically into the sky and out of sight. Middle brake has a splendid view anyway. The men and the young ones can manage the ceremony quite well on their own. but the sight of Totty sends Mrs. Maguire into a tightly controlled fit of hysteria. Your dress, Dorothy. How can you ever make your recitation now? Elizabeth will have to do it. Mother, it is a coal mine after all. And Mrs. Leake spending such care on the stitching. Oh, Totty, how can you be so careless? It will wash out, Mother. What will they think? Mr. Maguire's daughter? You will have to stay down here with me. You have missed your chance of fame. Oh, what a madam. Mr. Maguire, oh, Lord, where has Elizabeth got to? And she's wearing her blue. Not at all the right thing, Mr. Maguire. He can't hear you, Mother. Well, run and fetch him. This is a crisis, with a programme announced in the paper and your name in it. Mr. Maguire! That is why Miss Elizabeth Maguire, not her older sister Dorothy, as reported, rather nervously recited prophetic lines from Locksley Hall. For I dipped into the future, far as human eye could see, saw the vision of the world and all the wonders that would be. As Miss Mary Dixon, daughter of the company manager, drove the silver-plated spike, two misses and one strike according to Con the Brake, who counted everything, commemorating the opening of the Denniston Incline, and why Totty was free to walk hand in hand with Tom, away from the brakehead and the ceremony, away over the humming plateau, a good mile away, to a mossy hollow where they sat and then lay together in the sun, and where, because they were headstrong and in love, and of a mind to make their own future, Totty conceived Michael. On that day, Totty developed a taste for a landscape as wilful and contrary as herself, and bred the flavour into her son's bones. At the brakehead, Mr. Dixon, company manager, had stayed back for a word with mine manager, Mr. Denniston. The rest of the official party had plunged off the edge, teeth clamped to hold in place rocketing stomachs and hearts, until Con the Brake slows them just in time to arrange laughing, hearty faces for the women at middle break, who have laid out bacon and egg pie and corned beef sandwiches, and are now busy holding back the children until the men arrive. Up top, Mr. Dixon's wink at the two latecomers wandering back over the plateau gives way to a frown when he recognises Totty Maguire, whose dress now has a new set of stains. It's not the thing, young Tom. Mr. Maguire's daughter. Tom looks back stoutly, but it's Totty who answers. Tom wants a job, Mr. Dixon. You must need carpenters up here. You're right, we do. We could build accommodations up here, and our own. Maybe a boarding house if you'd help me, and we could run it. Mr. Denniston, mine manager, a progressive man and well-liked by the men, speaks up. We could do with some solid accommodation, sir. Tents are no comfort to a man in winter up here. Boarding houses now. He laughed and gave Tom a cuff. We may not be quite as fancy as that yet. Mr. Dixon frowns. Don't be too sure, Robert. Coal up here is as good as any I've seen in the world, and I know my coal. He looks out over barren rocks and scrub, but what he sees are the bags of coal stacked high and waiting for transport. An underground city of roads and crossroads driven through hard coal, an army of miners and miles of rails. He sees money pouring in and an easing of the heavy debt his company owes. Mr. Dixon is an optimist on this fine day. I'll wager you a pound to a penny, he says, that we'll have boarding houses, shops, streets, schools even, within the year. Two at most, he adds, because he is also a mean man who hates to lose a bet. He turns back to Tom. I'd be happy to give you a job, young Tom. I know your dad's work and he's sound. I'll help with the building of the boarding house too, on a proper financial basis, mind. But this is no place for a woman, Tom, let alone a well-bred one. Totty is getting up to speed to reply when Con the Brake, never one to hold back in a good debate, joins in with his thick foreign tongue. We're bred all sorts up here, sir. She might not be so outclass as you think. Also, he says with some pride, I'm thinking to bring a woman to the hill. They will come, sir. We must have them. Robert Denniston, mine manager, nods. We must have them, and will. Mr. Dixon still shakes his head at the thought of the stir back in Westport, of Mrs. Maguire's desolation. But Tom grins widely and offers his hand to the big man who has argued his case. Tom Hanratty, carpenter, he says. The giant removes one paw from the brake wheel and shakes briefly. Conrad, me, he answers. No one up here has conned the brake. Welcome, then. 3 years later, when Rose and Evangeline Strauss arrived, Hanratty's on the muddy lane known as Dixon Street was a fine guest house, 6 rooms and a basement under, and respectable, all 4 sides wooden, not like the icy iron sheds most people built. The other landmark home was Con the Brake's great log house, which Rose missed on her first night, for though it was down at the camp, Con had chosen the highest, driest spot, away from the rattle of the mine and the damp of the cliff. This fine edifice he had built for his beloved Mrs. C from fine West Coast beech logs felled by himself in the gorge and hauled up on the spinner, a dangerous contraption of ropes and chutes that brought all the timber up from the river below. An outlandish, foreign castle of a place it was, Con's log house, standing among the temporary tents and shacks of the camp like a whale in a school of dolphins. It was even grander than the home of the new mine manager, Eddie Carmichael, who'd replaced Mr. Denniston the previous year. Hanratty's and Rasmussen's, homes and families that would become lifelines to Rose, and dangerous rivals to her mother's ambition. Scobie's too, in a way, though they, of course, were different. Scobie's. Mr. William Dixon, the managing director of the Westport Coal Company, despite his breeding, could develop a good rage if the occasion called for it. One such occasion was when the list of his 20 miners recruited in England and now disembarked at Nelson was laid on the varnished wood of his office desk in Westport by his new mine manager, Eddie Carmichael. "Let them rot in Nelson, then," he had shouted to Eddie Carmichael. "I'll not have one of those nippy bastards within 20 miles of a company mine. We need the men, sir. We'll use the old gold miners."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.